A lot of people, if you stay in America, people in America still think America is ahead. But that's only because they only focus on chatbots. What they don't realize is that AI development, it's China is very focused on the product-driven part of it. And there is, like, right now a huge gap between what the Chinese industries are making in terms of AI robots versus what American companies are making, if that makes sense. I know this because I personally worked on a project like this recently. And I was on call with, so we had a couple of Americans on our side, and because we needed to do some kind of AI robots, so I was on call with this factory in Shenzhen. And then they had their one sales lady talking to us, because the sales lady was has, you know, we're trying to access this Chinese chip to put on our AI robots because the Chinese chips are good enough and they're cheap, right? You don't want to buy Nvidia because they're so expensive. So 15 minutes into this call, I realized America was cooked, because this lady, this sales lady, know more about how to make electronics board and the battery and the heat dissipation, heat management stuff that all the smart engineers that we have in America. And that was when I looked at myself. I was like, America's really in trouble. If you hear all these big talking about Silicon Valley about, you know, deploying AI to robots, they don't even know how to make a board. They don't know that they don't have the models needed for the board. You know, I bet the people in Silicon Valley never have to deal with what the battery life is for products that you need to use, or how to do it so that the your AI robot doesn't burn up from too much heating. So what we did was we actually tried different AI inference edge AI chips from different companies. So what we found was that Nvidia was the easiest to set up, obviously, because everything was written for it, but they were charging a ridiculous amount of money. And then we also tried Qualcomm, MediaTek, and two mainland Chinese companies, Rockchip and Exera. And we found out that the Rockchip and Exera, they were pretty affordable, but more importantly, they had very good software support for their the AI portion of it. So when you're running the models, you can use their the NPU, so the AI processing unit, to speed up the process of generating results. Then we tried Qualcomm and MediaTek. So MediaTek is a Taiwanese company, and Qualcomm, you know, is in San Diego. And because we thought, like, you know, like, if we want to bring the product to America, we need to have like a non-mainland option, right? And then we just found the software support from MediaTek and Qualcomm to be so lacking. Like, their NPU doesn't support the functionality, the operations needed for some of the most widely used models, like Qwen models, or, you know, stuff like conversion text to speech and then speech to text. So you can't actually use these chips because their NPU is effectively useless because of this. So this is what a lot of people don't realize. One, you know, if you want to have a working AI model, you have to use the Chinese, you have to use the models themselves have to be Chinese. The where you make them, the electronics board and stuff like that has to be China, because that's where the entire supply chain is. That's how the entire place where people know how to, like, put stuff in electronics, put the RAMs in there, put the audio things in there, hook it up to the battery, and how to do heat dissipation, maybe you put like a fan in there, and how to deal with the battery life, things like that. All the people that know how to do that are in Shenzhen right now. And then after that, the chip, which people would normally think as something that China's behind the West in, is actually not a problem in this case, because the one company that came out with this stuff first has which is Rockchip, they have the best software support out there. outside of Nvidia. And then I would get on these calls with the Chinese factories and ask them, like, you know, basically, are there competitors to us in this space? And they're like, yeah, yeah, plenty. We got so many people interested in doing this stuff here. And I'm pretty sure there are many people doing this in America, I can tell you that. Talk to our Indonesian factory, they're like, yeah, you should speed it up a little, because there's Chinese companies trying to do the exact same thing, do this product, getting it assembled in Indonesia, get the electronics board done in China, do the software in China, then get assembled in Indonesia and ship it to America. It's like, okay. Yeah, so that's kind of the just a lay of the land. Basically, if you want to get any kind of electronics done, I found out that the hard way, if you want to get any kind of electronics done with AI, you need to be in Shenzhen for about 3 or 4 months.
Now the question, my next question is, did you guys have this discussion before or after the liberation, the Tariff Liberation Day announcement?
Oh, definitely after. Definitely.
Oh, really?
After.
Really? So yeah, even after, you know, whatever 55% tariff, whatever, it would still make sense to get the Chinese hardware?
I mean, it just can't be done in America. Like, there's no expertise in doing this, right? Like, where am I going to find a guy that knows how to put the design and board together and put it together? Like, there's no factory in America doing that kind of stuff. We had some problem with, or just to give people an idea of like how much China dominates the electrical board space, what they called single board computers. In the Western country, there's this thing called Raspberry Pi. I don't know if you used it, but it's like designed in UK and made in UK/Japan/China, whatever. In China, they have Orange Pi, they have Banana Pi, they have Cypeat, and I'm pretty sure they have another Pi also. I can't remember now. But there's like, for every like Western option outside of China, there's like about 5 or 6 inside China itself. And you don't even know about them until you go to like AliExpress and just look up like boards that support this chip. And they all know what they're doing. And no matter where the headquarter of the chip, no matter where the headquarter of the chip design company is, even in China, all the factories are in Shenzhen.
That's amazing. We rarely hear about this in the mainstream media, because I just recall, like, this is not that long ago, like I think a month ago, there was an article coming out either in Wall Street Journal or New York Times that says, the Chinese are good at the assembling electronic stuff because the Chinese women, they have small hands. I mean, like, I can't believe I read that in like the paper of the records. But it's, oh my, anyway, so enough about the stupidity of the legacy media.
Yeah, like America is undefeated in copium, completely undefeated in that, okay? And it's written by a bunch of liberal arts majors that aren't into technology, that don't have to deal with this stuff, right? Honestly, unless you try to produce this, it is actually very hard to know what the lay of the land is. Like, I did not realize Quinn was so much better than Llama before I started this. I didn't even know Rockchip was so big. They're like an industry standard. They're like the de facto single board computer standard, because there's so much better support for them software-wise than others. I didn't know ESP32 was like the de facto industry standard before this, right? Like, they're just all these things that, because the entire ecosystem is inside China, how to make a board, the expertise behind that is just not known. People don't know like how much the electronics industry is just congregated there. I think there was a contact friend of mine, Mohsen Hart. He was returning to Shenzhen because, you know, his toy business, he does a lot of stuff there. And he was saying that basically, if you want to do electronics, you have to be in Shenzhen. Even if you're designing stuff in somewhere in middle of America, If you want to get the shit done, if you want to get it produced, you have to be in Shenzhen. Because the expertise there is just unparalleled elsewhere. Like, where in America are you going to find several factories where people know how to source different chips, source different batteries, source boards, the audio components, the fans, and put them, assemble them together at a manageable cost? Like, I didn't know how much any of these stuff cost before, right? But the people in Shenzhen, they all know it.
But the argument of the Silicon Valley tech bro is that, okay, sure, China dominating hardware, but that doesn't matter because we can just concentrate on the design of the software, right? And that's, as long as we get the AGI out of the door first, you know, we're going to win. What do you say to that?
So it depends. I think there is applications that doesn't require hardware, right? Like, just right now, the OpenAI reasoning models just by themselves are pretty useful for if you want to do research reports, if you want to have like a summary of things, if you want to plan out vacations, and or even if you have like a programming question that you have for it, then it can do that for you. But it's one of those things where once America gets to something that looks like AGI, China will get there maybe at worst like 6 months later, right? And nothing is going to happen in the 6 months that's going to say, oh, China's done. So the there's no, in terms of computational resources, it seems like China's doing pretty well there. In terms of energy resources, you know, China has no issue with supplying power to the data centers, where America is it's a huge issue. And there's not just the power itself, but also the all the other part of the supply chain that goes into the data center, a lot of electrical stuff that, you know, America relies on the rest of the world to build its data centers. But, you know, aside from stuff like this, there are a lot of areas like material science, biotech, auto manufacturing, aero design, and things like that, where we're already seeing Chinese industry really using AI. Like, for example, EVs. Companies in China are now able to churn out models in like a year and a half because the process got sped up by the usage of AI in designing the cars. And whereas America and Western countries, you know, it still has much longer development cycles because of that. So there is that. And I think AI robots and any kind of AI robotic stuff is a huge industry in the future. And, you know, it's very hard for people in America to just do software and wait for like the partners in Shenzhen to do the hardware part of it, because one, you're not in the same time zone. You're not next to them. So the just in terms of getting a help and things like that, you can't iterate product as quickly when you're not next to the supply chain.
Fair.
And the reason for this is pretty obvious, right? Like, if I'm doing product development and I need someone from Shenzhen, I need to be on the phone every night at like 10 o'clock. And if you have a family, that's a real problem. So it's very hard to iterate your product at the same speed as a team in China that can speak the same language, that can try it out, that has more access to a lot of data also, and can get the cost down because they don't have to go through Indonesia and then ship the product over here to America, right? So it's a real thing, okay? This is a real thing.
That's thanks to the tariff, right? That's thanks to Trump's tariff, right?
Okay. Yes.
Yeah.
And by the way, the Indonesian factories, they're running very hot right now. So, you know, like, it's not like they have all infinite capacity that can just get this stuff through. Trump is probably going to have to make the tariffs 500% in order for the manufacturing to come of that stuff to come back to America, probably.
Well, I mean, the problem with the tariff is, you know, tariff could work if it's paired with an industrial policy. But Trump's administration think you can just do tariff and everything will magically resolve itself. But that's not how it works. You know, traditionally, tariff has been paired with industrial policy to actually target a specific segment of manufacturing. You know, tariff works if you actually have to manufacturing, but right now, what Trump is actually doing is creating a whole lot of uncertainty in the market. And one thing the business really hate is uncertainty.